Hi, I'm Lisa Prather, and welcome to The Voice of Health with our host, Dr. Robert Prather of the Prather Practice, where lives are changed every day through the natural approach to healthcare.
Well, today we're talking about pain, science or mystery. And Dr. Prather, you always come up with these titles. You're so proud of them. So we'll find out what you mean more about science or mystery. Sure. But what is pain?
And, you know, that's one of the million-dollar questions. Mm-hmm. And the answer, you know, you try to combine science and you know, what the reality of it is, and it's still a mystery. Mm-hmm. Because some of the rules that we come up with on pain don't always follow. You know, so it is kind of like, you know, a combination of science and mystery. And right now, what they talk about is the theories of pain. Mm-hmm. And we emphasize theory. Mm-hmm. Because pain is basically a theory at this point, and our understanding has improved quite a bit, but we still haven't really nailed it. You know, so you know, there's a lot of misconceptions. There's a lot of rules that are broken for every different type of science that we try to put together on it, and throughout time, there's always been different theories. Mm-hmm. where we've operated from, and most of those theories always have some exceptions.
Okay. So it's a theory.
It's a theory.
We got that.
Yeah. So, you know, when you talk about what is pain, they're not even quite sure if it's the same from person to person.
Mm-hmm. Definitely people have different thresholds.
Oh, absolutely.
What someone calls pain, someone
sure
wouldn't call pain.
Right. It's really quite a, it is a sensation, and there are, you know, different kinds of pains. People have actually talked about that, but, you know, so it's kind of a combination of things. Matter of fact, the earliest theory of pain that's recorded is Aristotle, and he didn't actually think of pain as a physiological type of thing. It was more of an emotion.
Mm. That was Aristotle. So there was an emotion connection?
Right. Hippocrates thought it was an imbalance in humors. There's a lot of different types of thoughts on what pain is, and actually each one of the different types of theories on that seems to hold some valid information.
Interesting. So why do we have pain?
Well, you know, that's also one of the things that has been debated. Well, you know, what is the benefit of pain? And pain is basically a communication of our body to our brain saying, hey, this isn't really that great. Mm-hmm. So pain is an important part of being able to survive. Mm-hmm. Matter of fact, there are people who are born without pain sensation. Mm-hmm. And it's a very dangerous life for them.
Right. They can lose limbs. Right.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So not everybody has pain. And some people out there would say, wow, wouldn't it be nice not to experience pain? Mm-hmm. You know, just not to have that. But your life expectancy really drops. Pain is something that is important for survival.
Well, you burned yourself a little bit last night.
I did, and I had some pain, and it told me to move my hand quickly because I was
right.
Right. Uh-huh. So, you know, so there wasn't any
more.
You
have a nice little blister today.
I have a nice little blister. Isn't that cute?
Uh-huh.
I was cooking, and I was moving the tray out and the pot hand.
Right, and if you didn't know your pain receptors didn't kick in.
Right. I would have gone ahead and burned some more tissue.
Mm-hmm. So what are the different, you talked a little bit about the theories.
Sure.
What different theories of pain are there?
There are tons of theories out there. We talked about Aristotle, that he thought that it was more of an emotion. Mm-hmm. On the same level as pleasure, and that the emotions play a big role. And that is it's interesting, but there is a lot of truth on that. Your different emotional state does have a big effect on your pain perception.
Mm-hmm.
So that is very true. And from culture to culture, it is something that people can moderate. There were different types of ways that people actually work to and strive mm-hmm. to not to feel pain. There are people out there who can put hooks through their back, through different muscles, and then hang themselves from the ceiling.
Don't picture that.
You know, that, you know, just to demonstrate that they that pain is not something that, that bothers them. Mm. Childbirth can be a very painful experience. But
how do you know?
Well, good question. I've certainly been told that. And but one of the things that you learned to do was the Bradley method.
Mm-hmm.
And that helped your pain perception quite a bit, didn't it?
Yes, the deep breathing,
the relaxation, all those different
the
things.
The environment
had a very big difference, made a very big difference on the pain level. So Aristotle, Hippocrates had the four humors. The first one that was considered more scientific was the specificity theory,
mm-hmm.
where the amount, basically what they said, Descartes said, and some of the others, that the amount of damage that was done to the tissue had a big effect on the level of pain. So he brought that up. There's the intensive theory. There's a pattern theory. And the most recent one is the gate control theory. And all of those seem to play a big role on that. Probably the most accepted theories right now is a combination of the gate theory and pattern theory. But those do have a big effect on how people treat pain.
Mm-hmm.
So your theory of pain has a does affect on how you approach the pain, and so it's a very important type of thing to have an idea of.
Well, why is it so hard to study pain?
Well, we were thinking about doing an experimentation, and we were asking for volunteers. Is there anyone out there that would really like to volunteer to do a pain study? And
point.
Well,
good point.
You know, and even animal studies. I mean, you can't.
Oh, right.
You know, that would be.
Oh my.
Pretty cruel.
Yeah.
You know, bring in your little kitten and let's check out how much pain they can tolerate.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, that's not a really fun thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
So there are limitations on what you can do scientifically and ethically to study pain.
Well, what influence play a part in pain perception?
Well, you know, there's an awful lot of things that they found with pain perception. If you couldn't see something, you know, like you were blindfolded, and they did experiments on people where they say, okay, now we're going to do a pain study on you, and we're going to burn you.
Mm-hmm.
And they came up with ice, and then they touched them like that, and people would actually yelp and ow, and
think they were being burned.
Thought they were being burned.
Mm-hmm.
And people could even develop blisters from it.
Hmm.
Whereas if they were watching it and they did the same thing, they said, oh, wow, that's just cold.
Do they really do that?
Yeah, they actually did that as an experimentation.
Some people have volunteered.
Right, there are people who actually do volunteer, but, you know, there's limitations. So they couldn't actually burn them because that would have been ethically wrong, but they told them they were going to burn them.
Right.
So if you're watching what's going on, can kind of see what's happening, knowledge of what's going on is a very important part mm-hmm. of pain perception.
Mm-hmm.
They find that patients, when it's like, oh, I've got this abdominal pain, and the doctor goes, I have no idea what that is,
mm-hmm.
their pain perception goes up.
Hmm.
If they sit there,
what, a lack of understanding?
If there's a lack of understanding, if you sit down there and say, oh, you know what, you've got some stones in your gallbladder.
Mm-hmm.
Here's a picture of them. This is what's causing it. Blocks over here. We're going to be able to take care of that for you. The patient goes, oh, okay, wow, that's a relief. You know, it's something that's going to be gone here pretty soon.
Mm-hmm.
And their pain level automatically drops.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as they're grading it. So even the knowledge of what's going on, the scariest thing is not really understanding, and that has a very definite perception of pain.
Well, I know even in birthing, I did the Bradley method, and it was very based on knowledge. It was a 12-week course.
Sure.
I mean, I understood. By the time I gave birth, so that knowledge did really help me to know what's coming next. And
yeah, if you don't know, pain perception actually goes up. One of the things is also your what's going on. They did a study on people who were in battle.
Mm-hmm.
And let's say they had their big toe blown off.
Mm-hmm.
And they compared it to, like, a construction worker that had his toe taken off.
Mm-hmm.
And they compared the levels of pain and how much pain medication they needed to be able to get it under control. The guy who was here in the States where, you know, this happened, mm-hmm. the pain was excruciating.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Because this was something that was unexpected. It was something that, you know, nobody else was really having happen. And, you know, the pain level was a 10 out of 10,
mm-hmm.
is what they put down, which was very common. They go into a battlefield and they talk about somebody who had their big toe blown off,
mm-hmm.
and they said, well, what's your pain level? Oh, maybe a 2, maybe a 3.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because the guy next door had his leg blown off.
Hmm.
You know what I mean?
Wow.
That was right next to you?
Maybe that's for that emotion.
Huh. Exactly. And they were very serious. You know, do you need any pain medicine? No, it's just my big toe. It's no big
mm-hmm.
deal.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I'm going to go home from it, so this is actually a good thing.
So, well, the construction worker got to go home, too.
Yeah. So, you know, it's your surrounding, too, and how much people are suffering, what are the possibilities. So all those types of things kind of play a role in it.
Okay. When we come back, let's talk about the theory of pain that the Prather Practice believes in. Pain, science, or mystery?
You can win a free 60-minute massage in a relaxing spa at the Prather Practice. Each month, we have a drawing to give away a free massage to one of our lucky Facebook and Twitter fans. Follow us on Facebook and Twitter on our website at thevoiceofhealthradio.com. This is The Voice of Health with Dr. Robert Prather. The Voice of Health Wellness Tip with Dr. Robert Prather of the Prather Practice. What is ECP therapy?
ECP stands for external counterpulsation therapy. And just to put it into a nutshell, ECP is an aerobic exercise machine. Now, you sit there and say, well, why do you need an aerobic exercise machine? It is the number one treatment for cardiovascular disease. If you look at the research and want to find out, well, how do I fix my cardiovascular disease, you know, whatever it might be, always within the scientific literature, aerobic exercise is one of the most proven, most effective means of reversing cardiovascular disease. So, but the problem is I have people who I sit there and I look at them and I say, well, you know, what do I do about this problem that I have, Doc? And I said, well, go out and run 5 miles, you know, every day. And of course, they all laugh because you know, it took every effort that they had from going to the waiting room into the exam room,
right?
And they're out of breath. So that didn't work. So what was actually done was develop a machine that actually simulates the effects on the body of aerobic exercise, and that's where ECP comes in. And what occurs with ECP is that there's actually a second heart kind of put into the body.
Mm-hmm.
It's on the outside, but as the heart goes into relaxation, that's when it actually gets its blood. So what we do is we actually have blood pressure cuffs around the legs. it presses on the legs, and we get a huge amount of blood that goes back up to the heart. And the heart is very regenerative, and you get about 10 times as much oxygen with this particular type of treatment than what you normally would. And you get a regeneration of the heart. You also get a cleaning out of the arteries. And you actually get a huge amount of changes in the whole physiology of the body. So all the benefits of aerobic exercise are actually found in ECP, which are absolutely the number one way that you can be able to reverse cardiovascular disease, diabetes, and many other problems.
Schedule your appointment at the Prather Practice, 317-848-8048. That's 317-848-8048. Or learn more on our website at thevoiceofhealthradio.com. The Prather Practice, restoring hope.
And I'm feeling good.
You're listening to The Voice of Health with Dr. Robert Prather of The Prather Practice, the most comprehensive wellness center in the Midwest.
We're talking today about pain, science, or mystery. And Dr. Prather, you talked about the different theories. What theory of pain does the Prather Practice believe in?
Well, we do a combination. I mean, we see the value in each of these different things, but how we talk about pain is something called the theory of energy flow. So energy flow is really what we look at, and then also the pain threshold theory.
Okay.
Which is very close to the gait theory, but a little bit different.
So what is meant by energy flow?
Well, there are five pathways of energy that has been recognized for an awful long time. There's the nervous system, there's the cerebral spinal fluid, there's the circulatory system, there's the lymphatic system, and the electromagnetic system are the five pathways of energy. And one of the things is plus a pain threshold level. And that's the reason that we like that is because it's very practical and extremely effective.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, you know, as I'm examining someone, I can tell the difference between the pains that are going on between each one of them and can identify them.
Mm-hmm.
And how you treat them are completely different.
Well, it's interesting because this is pillar one of the eight pillars of perfect health.
Exactly.
That we talk about. And we do have a radio show on that, the eight pillars of perfect health, and you always start with the energy flow.
Yes.
And when you're evaluating a patient, is that where you start also?
That is where we start, because that is the quickest way to make a difference on people. Very definitely the quickest way to change the pain patterns.
Mm-hmm.
Because the theory of energy flow is pain is a blockage of energy.
Mm.
That's why you can sit there and on people, cut them open and do surgery without pain medication. That was the big thing that opened up the whole acupuncture mm-hmm. aspect. And what you're doing with the different needles is they are placing them in different spots to reroute the energy of the body.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can actually cut people open and do whatever you need to without any perception of pain, because you're rerouting the energy, and that's why that works. Also, as we are working with people, if we can get the energy flowing in the different five pathways,
mm-hmm.
then you can get the pain under control. But you have to identify which pathways are involved, how they're actually blocked, and as you get those open, then you can reduce that pain level quite dramatically.
Go over those again.
Sure.
There's five energy pathways. Nervous system,
cerebral spinal fluid, electromagnetic energy, lymphatic energy, and the vascular system.
So how are each of these treated in your office?
Well, as you're looking at each of those, there are different treatments, and we work on getting those opened up. Like with chiropractic, there are over 40 different recognized systems of doing different types of adjustments.
Mm-hmm.
I've sat down with some of my friends and came up with over 400.
Wow.
and different types of adjustments, manipulations of the body, body work, concentrate on different systems. We have Logan Basic, we have cerebral spinal fluid type of adjustments, sacro-occipital type of techniques. Those work on the cerebral spinal fluid.
Mm-hmm.
So there are very specific types of work that you can do for the cerebral spinal fluid flow, which has very definite patterns of pain.
Mm-hmm.
You have the nervous system, where we have different forms of chiropractic. The vascular system, the neurovascular system, there's specific adjustments. So we've learned how to do lymphatic type of adjustments. We've learned how to work with the electromagnetic energy, which is mainly acupuncture.
Mm-hmm. So
each of these different types of areas has a very set pattern of different types of work that we do to get those opened up. And one of the problems that we feel that a lot of the failure of pain treatments at this point
mm-hmm.
is because the medical system really doesn't recognize energy flow and how to really work with that to get the pain perception down.
Interesting. Yeah.
You know, and then even as you're going into different types of treatments, if you're not aware of how to work with each of those five pathways, you might be very good at the nervous system,
mm-hmm.
but if you know nothing about how to open up the cerebral spinal fluid, there are a lot of different types of pain patterns that you are not going to be able to fix.
Mm-hmm.
So
Makes sense. It's
an encompassing type of thing, and one of the things I found in my when I was going through school is I went around to different types of chiropractors, different types of practitioners, and I knew a one practitioner who was excellent at the cerebral spinal fluid, but really didn't deal with anything else. So there was a very certain set of people that he had a lot of success with.
Mm-hmm.
And the other people, if someone had a lymphatic system, he really couldn't do anything for them to get their pain levels down.
So you're evaluating when someone comes in and has pain, you know, what energy pathway is blocked.
Correct.
Interesting. And it might be more than one.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, oftentimes we can have all five. And I even go through the patient. Okay, now we've cleared up the nervous system. That's what I wanted to work on first.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're going to start clearing up the cerebral spinal fluid.
Mm-hmm. And for our listeners, the cerebral spinal fluid,
yes.
right, runs in the spinal cord?
Spinal cord, yes. From the sacrum all the way up to the skull.
Mm-hmm.
And there are certain definite pain patterns that occur with that. Disc pain is actually a very much a part of that particular type of pattern. That's why very specific types of adjustments are important for a disc herniation to get that pain down.
Mm-hmm.
But we get that down very quickly because I concentrate on the cerebral spinal fluid.
Interesting. So how effective is this energy flow theory in treating patients?
It's amazingly effective.
Mm-hmm.
We find that of all the different types of theories, this is the most practical.
Mm-hmm.
Now, as I talk to medical doctors and other different types of people, they say, well, prove it. Well, you know, I can't, but you can't prove any of the theories at this point.
Mm-hmm.
But on a practical basis, it beats all the other theories.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you're really looking on making changes, the proof is in the pudding.
Mm-hmm.
And I've never seen any of the other theories utilized and how to work with it
mm-hmm.
With the same results.
Right, and we've talked the past shows about the addiction to pain medication.
There's the other aspect of the whole pain is the pain threshold.
Mm-hmm.
And of course that's just really collapses with the pharmaceutical method
mm-hmm.
over a long period of time. You also, that's where, we have, when we're talking about our type of care, we're talking about structure function. And working with the five energies is basically a big part of our structural
mm-hmm.
Area, but then also we have the functional area. Now, the functional is very, very helpful because that's where you get into the pain threshold. So one of the things is, if you've had pain for a long period of time, your ability to handle pain threshold needs to be helped, because the pain itself, the body tries to block it. Mm-hmm. So it utilizes a lot of vitamins, minerals, amino acids to produce an increase in energy to try to handle it. And oftentimes when we're getting people better, the first thing that they notice is, because they have such high levels of pain, is that their energy is better even before their pain perception is better.
Wow.
Because it's taking less energy in their system to keep their pain threshold high.
Because a lot of their energy is just going to that pain.
Going to that pain, and it's wearing them out.
Interesting.
So I can tell, because of the energy flow, that I'm making progress on the patient before the patient actually knows it.
Mm-hmm. And you can find areas of pain they didn't even know they had.
And that's the other thing, is that pain is selective. If you have, you know, really bad pain in your neck, you're not going to be aware of some pain that's going down in your foot.
Mm-hmm.
So as I'm examining people, I can see and evaluate and say, wow, you have right here a real bad blockage of energy. Mm-hmm. And I poke it, and they go, oh, ouch.
Mm-hmm.
They don't actually say
that.
Yeah. That hurt.
No swearing in the
office. And I go, yeah, I know. And it's, and the patients say, wow, you know my body better than I do.
Oh, I hear that all the time. How did he know? I came in here for neck pain. How did he know my foot hurt?
Right.
You know?
And there's patterns on that. There's ways of perceiving it. And I can examine the body and tell the patient more about what's going on, because the brain doesn't really want to handle everything at once.
Mm-hmm. Right. Thank goodness.
Yes.
All right. When we come back, more on pain, science, or mystery.
Listen to the Voice of Health Radio on your smartphone or tablet on all of the top radio apps available. TuneIn Radio, Stitcher, and iHeartRadio. You can find these apps and more on our website at thevoiceofhealthradio.com. This is the Voice of Health with Dr. Robert Prather.
Laughter is the best medicine.
2 years ago, she signed us up for a health club. She thought that would be fun. 2 years. I've been there once. Drive by it every day. It's right on the way to Cinnabon. Come on, we'd all exercise if the weight we gained was in a more uncomfortable place on our bodies. Where do we gain weight? Our stomachs and our bodies. It's not in our way, is it? A couple pounds on your forehead, that would get you to a gym, wouldn't it? Man, I can't see nothing. People would be laughing at you too, wouldn't they? Hey, Skullmaster, you want a Krispy Kreme? That goes right to my head.
A special message from the DTS Weight Loss Center at the Prather Practice.
Are you tired of making the same weight loss resolution only to end up right back where you started? Let the professionals at DTS Weight Loss Center take all the frustration out of dieting. Our nutritionists and wellness coaches know what works for every body type and can develop a plan specific to your needs throughout your medically supervised program. Make the change by visiting us online at DTSweightLossCenter.com. Dedicate. Transform. Succeed.
When you call the Prather Practice to schedule your appointment at our DTS Weight Loss Center, mention the Voice of Health radio show and you'll receive a free initial consultation plus a free body composition analysis. 317-848-8048. That's 317-848-8048. The DTS Weight Loss Center at the Prather Practice. Dedicate, transform, listening to the Voice of Health with Dr. Robert Prather of the Prather Practice, where we get to the root cause of your health issue.
We're talking today about pain, science, or mystery. And Dr. Prather, are people always aware of their pain?
Not always. I mean, we find pain on people that, and oftentimes it's because they have pain elsewhere.
Mm-hmm.
So being aware of that, and then even when, like, we've had people come in with a car accident, and one of the things that we recommend is that they come in for an evaluation afterwards. I've had patients who came in and said, you know, I was in a bad car accident. but I don't really seem to have a whole lot of pain.
Mm-hmm.
And then I go in and examine their neck and their low back and other different types of things, and they're going, ow, 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 ow.
Mm-hmm.
There is a very big effect of the brain mm-hmm. on pain. And people aren't always aware of their pain, or people are over-perceptive of their pain.
Mm-hmm.
There is a, you know, there's a whole thing of people. I've had patients who came in and said, you know, I recently had an Amish lady came in,
mm-hmm.
and she was really a tough old lady. I mean, she was a tough old bird.
Uh-huh.
And he says, you know, her husband goes, you know, I want her checked out. You've done an awful lot for me.
Mm-hmm.
And she kind of limps a little bit, and, you know, I see her move, and it's just not quite right. She says she doesn't hurt.
Mm-hmm.
And I go in there and palpate, and I can feel, you know, the blockage and the spasm and all the different types of aspects that go into pain, and it was just all over the place. And it took a lot for me to kind of get her to wince.
Mm-hmm. Tough old bird.
She was a tough old bird. And then when we did her x-rays, she was a disaster.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, she was one of these people who just mentally didn't acknowledge pain.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that mm-hmm. just wasn't in, that wasn't what you did. That's what not how you lived. And he said all of her family's like that.
Mm-hmm.
And there are genetic aspects of pain
mm-hmm.
that some people can really handle large amounts, and there's even different perceptions and cultures and races and those types of things that have been very well documented. And she was one of these people who just didn't acknowledge pain. There are people who have been in pain for so long
mm-hmm.
that even after everything's all fixed throughout their body, they still perceive pain.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason is because there is a what we call a pain pattern in the brain,
mm-hmm.
where the pain is either augmented, or it is something that has just developed the pathways for so long that they actually perceive the pain. And that's one of the problems with pain medications, analgesics, especially opiates. Once you've been on them for an awful long period of time,
mm-hmm.
it seems to create a pattern of pain in the brain that remains there even after the pain is gone.
Mm.
So the you know, one of the main problems that we find with opiates is that it will eventually start to create pain where there is no physical reason for it.
Mm-hmm.
And that becomes a real problem. There was a situation with a one of our past medical directors had a daughter that had headaches. Mm-hmm. Ever since she was like 12, and she was in her later 30s, and we treated her, basically cleared up all the underlying problems, but she still had the headaches.
Mm-hmm.
And there was no real physical reason as we checked her. And I sit there and I says, you know, it was because she was continuing on her pain medicine. I said, the pain medicine is actually creating in the brain the headaches.
Mm-hmm.
So we did got her off of those, put her on some homeopathics and some supplements,
mm-hmm.
and lo and behold, all of her headaches were gone.
Wow.
So that is something that is found with analgesics, is they can keep the pain going
mm-hmm.
even after you no longer have the pain. The mm-hmm. underlying problem.
Interesting.
So, you know, and when it gets locked into the brain like that, we need to go after the brain.
Mm-hmm. And there's so much, it seems like the brain, there's going to be just a whole new awareness. And I think there's going to be a lot more research done on the brain.
Yeah, with the ability to monitor the brain at this point, the technology is moving forward. MRIs, EEGs, different types of those. That's one of the things we do in here. And then discovering what are the patterns on the brain and then actually working with it. One of the ways that we do that is through the ear.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, let's talk about the different treatments that are helpful for pattern of pain in the brain.
One of the things that has been found that is extremely helpful is auricular therapy. Mm-hmm. And we have a lot of different ways of working with that. Auricular therapy is something that has been around for thousands of years. And it, the way that we describe people, because they're, why are you working on my ear to affect the brain, mm-hmm. is that it seems to be the keyboard to the brain. There is neurological connections that go on there. And interestingly enough, auricular therapy, even though it sounds kind of out there, mm-hmm. is actually probably the most proven therapy in the world. Mm-hmm. Because you can hit different points on the brain, and through an MRI, you can actually see different patterns in the brain and changes that take place.
You meant you hit different points on the ear.
On the ear.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, on
can
the ear.
Uh-huh.
Did I say the brain?
Yeah.
Okay. You can hit different points on the ear, and then you can see the immediate changes on the brain.
Mm-hmm.
So you can then be able to change the brain patterns to get the brain perception of pain to change.
Mm-hmm.
And oftentimes the pain is completely coming from the brain,
mm-hmm.
and you have to work with the brain to be able to get that changed. And we have direct auricular therapy, and then we have a new technology called P-Stim.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a new area of treatment that we're very excited about.
Mm-hmm.
And I've had some amazing results with that. I had one poor gentleman who had been, he was a veteran, had been injured quite a bit, had been put on a tremendous amount of opiate and different analgesic types of therapies, which had just really made the problem worse. And he was just in a desperate situation, wanted to get off of those areas. We went in, corrected the original problems with the injuries to the body,
mm-hmm.
But still had, could tell a very big difference, and had been able to reduce his opiate consumption quite a bit. But then we got into the auricular therapy, especially the P-Stim is really where he got over everything, mm-hmm. was able to stop all of his opiates. He's just a different guy.
Right.
He's happy. You know, you actually found out who he really was, because
mm-hmm.
it had changed his personality and had gone through quite a metamorphosis, because we were able to, and he was able to do the withdrawal without any problems.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're looking for opioid ability to go through getting off of it without going through the horrible effects of that,
mm-hmm.
Auricular therapy is absolutely incredible.
And the P-Stim?
And the P-Stim.
Right.
And what's nice about the P-Stim is it's a continuous type of a treatment.
Right.
You can't walk around with me treating your ear on a regular basis.
Right. You wear the earpiece for 4 days on, and you have it off for 3 days.
Sure.
And every 2 weeks, we like to do a round of four. Really seems to be effective, but it's been a night. I mean, the conditions that it addresses, you know, not only arthritis and joint pain, neck pain, back pain, you know, helps with smoking cessation, because it works.
Actually, any addiction.
Any addiction, yeah. Migraines, depression, fibromyalgia, insomnia.
Sure.
Shingles, sciatica.
Right.
There's a whole list.
Well, depression is our feeling is very closely related to pain. When you're depressed, your pain levels increase quite dramatically. And both of those can be brain patterns, and you can change those brain patterns by utilizing the P-Stim.
Mm-hmm.
And the P-Stim is excellent because it's a continuous type of a treatment, and it will permanently change the brain patterns so that they're more normal. And as you get those normalized, then you no longer have the pain or the addictions. And it also changes the whole depressive mode, because you change the depression patterns that are in the brain.
Yeah. Makes sense. Well, thank you, Dr. Prather. Pain, science or mystery?
Never miss an episode of The Voice of Health so that you can stay informed and empowered about your health. Get a podcast of our show automatically delivered to you every week by signing up for our show on iTunes. You can find that link on our website at thevoiceofhealthradio.com. And don't forget, thevoiceofhealthradio.com has complete archives of all of our past episodes with an audio library of information to help you add more life to your years and more years to your life. This is The Voice of Health with Dr. Robert Prather. The Voice of Health Wellness Tip with Dr. Robert Prather of the Prather Practice. What role does structure function care play in treating infertility?
What we're looking at with the structure function care is basically there are things that are out of balance and through the system. There are toxins, there are infections, there are other different types of things that could be going on through the system that is preventing the body from becoming pregnant or even carrying a pregnancy to term. Mm-hmm. Determining what those are, figuring out the proper course, is where we really shine through and just getting people healthy.
So what would you, someone coming in, you know, with infertility, what would they experience? What diagnostics would you recommend?
Very thorough blood test. And mm-hmm. we'd be looking at all the different basic functions of the body. We need to know, are there toxicities? Are there infections that are going on? Are there other different types of issues? Toxins. So blood work would be very, very important. We would also need to do a hair analysis. The reason that we're looking at that is there are certain types of heavy metals that are very well known to cause infertility. Lead would be a very direct one, and hair analysis is an excellent way to pick that up. We would also want to do a see what's going on in the gut, because mm-hmm. it has a lot to do with the immune system. Matter of fact, we usually find the key to endometriosis, which is a big reason why women can't get pregnant, mm-hmm. Coming from the gut. So mm-hmm. as we fix the gut, the endometriosis goes away. So that's an important type of way, just really checking the body from head to toe. We need to know what the hormones are doing, you know, just every single different aspect on that. Also, we need to determine the fat percentage mm-hmm. of the body.
Does that affect infertility?
It does. You can actually be too low on your fat percentage or too high. Mm-hmm. The happy rate for best fertility is a body fat percentage of between 20 and 25% for a female. Mm-hmm. And that's where women are the most fertile. You know, the fat percentage is also a very important part because it changes the pH of the body. It mm-hmm. changes the endocrine system. The farther away from that number that you get, the less likely that you would actually be able to get pregnant. Fat will actually produce hormones, and they aren't the good kind of hormones. A male who has a too high of a fat percentage, their fertility rate actually drops.
Schedule your appointment at the Prather Practice, 317-848-8048. That's 317-848-8048. Or learn more on our website at thevoiceofhealthradio.com. The Prather Practice, restoring hope. It's a beautiful day. Sky falls, it feels like it's a beautiful day. You're listening to The Voice of Health with Dr. Robert Prather of The Prather Practice, where our mission is restoring hope to our patients.
Well, today I have Angie Nuttall, owner of the Corporate Talent Institute, with us. Welcome, Angie.
Thank you.
You're also an executive coaching, which I am part of.
Yes.
And feel privileged to be part of, and a patient of the Prather Practice.
Exactly. I'm a very proud patient.
There's a lot of P's in that.
That's right.
Proud patient of the Prather Practice. Well, Angie, let's talk about, you've had success with chiropractic care. Tell us your success story.
Well, I have a lot of success stories around chiropractic care, and it's probably a good idea to talk about where chiropractic care came into my life. Mm-hmm. I was over in Iraq for 3 years, and I was an HR defense contractor. So my job was pretty hectic, and we were setting up structure for our contractors to come in and support our military. And after about 3 years, one day I had a serious fall. And I didn't know this, but I had damaged a couple of vertebrae in my neck. And so I suddenly became very ill, very sick, severe headaches, and so I had to come back to the States to find out what had happened. And as fate would have it, my sister-in-law was and still is an upper cervical chiropractor, and so she recommended that I go and see a chiropractor.
Mm-hmm.
So I went and saw a chiropractor and a medical doctor,
mm-hmm.
and I very quickly realized that the chiropractor knew more about what he was talking about compared to the medical doctor.
Uh-huh.
And not to say that medicine isn't important, but in this case, it was obvious that I had some spinal injuries and those needed mm-hmm. to be repaired. So I started getting connected with chiropractic care then. And then later on, many years later, I was still continuing the care mm-hmm. and I had a couple of car accidents and they worsened my situation, and that's how I ended up on your doorstep
mm-hmm.
where you put me through a pretty regimented process to get back on the road to health, and I made a very powerful recovery as a result of following that treatment plan.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm a big advocate of chiropractic care.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you've had chiropractic care.
Yeah. I did have another chiropractor here, but when I had the car accident, I wasn't finding the right kind of care. There wasn't anybody who practiced the upper cervical
right,
care,
right.
And that's exactly what I needed.
Mm-hmm.
So when I ran across you and my sister-in-law helped connect us,
yes,
it was the perfect fit.
Yes, and you were a good patient, by the way.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Followed your treatment plan.
Yes.
Because we did also not only the chiropractic adjusting, but
right.
acupuncture
mm-hmm.
and the auricular therapy,
yeah.
and then the corrective exercise.
Yeah, it was very powerful.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, I'll just say that it wasn't always easy to follow the regimen, but it mm-hmm. was just the consistent care and following through with the treatment plan that really made the difference.
Right. And now we hardly see you for the adjustment, do we?
Right.
That's what happens.
That's exactly right.
So how does your chiropractic care success influence your work with your clients? Tell us a little bit about what you do.
Okay. Well, I just want to say this, no pun intended, but it really taught me that you have to have your head on straight.
You've heard that somewhere
yeah,
before.
Yeah, and you really have to take care of yourself. And so what I realized is that stress really has such a serious impact on your body. And I was in corporate America for over 20 years and in executive leadership positions and had quite a bit of demand on my time and my schedule. I was traveling globally. And even though I was getting chiropractic care, it mm-hmm. wasn't optimal because I wasn't taking care of myself on the other side of mm-hmm. things, on the emotional side of things. And so the stress was getting to me. And what I learned once I started my consulting firm is I learned how to help people to balance that other part and to really look at themselves as a whole person, not just a mm-hmm. part of a person.
Mm-hmm.
And so I do a lot of work around leadership development, cultural engagement. I do a lot of executive coaching. I teach people how to show up with executive presence, and all of that really emanates from being at peace with who you are and what your circumstances are. And that's where people really struggle.
Mm-hmm.
They can get the care, the chiropractic care or the medical care, but they're not helping their situation because they're not really taking care of the stressful side of things and living a life that's meaningful for them. So that's where I come in and help to bridge that gap.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. Well, tell us more about what talent remodeling is and what kind of clients you typically work with.
So talent remodeling is something that I had trademarked. It is a registered trademark, and it is a process that I use with people to help them to really discover what their core talents are and to help them to reshape their skills so they can reinvent and reposition their mission. And all of us have a mission. We just, many of us don't realize what that is. We go to work every day, we show up, we come home, we feel exhausted, we're doing the same things over, but all of us have natural talents. Mm-hmm. And I help people to tap into those talents so that they can step into the role that they're really called to do. And how I work with people and clients, I actually have three different groups that I work with. And the first is I work with organizations. So I work directly with CEOs, business leaders, and HR teams, and I help them to discover the potential that they have in their organization. I help them work on leadership development, cultural transformation, and I do coaching. Then I also work with individual business people. So you don't have to wait for your organization to develop you. You can go out on your own and you can get coaching. You can learn executive presence. You can be a part of some of the programs that I create for the public use. And then I also work with people who are in business for themselves when they're trying to start up and they're trying to figure out, how do I get my business going? How do I create relationships with people? So all three of those areas are areas that I work in.
Mm-hmm. What ways, specific ways, can you help people and organizations who are listening in today?
Well, specifically, you know, if you are an organization and you are a small to mid-size organization, one thing that my company does is we can come in and assess your situation and see what you need in terms of human resources services. And that might result in you needing someone to come in and build HR for you, or restructure what you have, or even have an HR generalist come on site and cover services. So we call that outsourcing. Mm-hmm. And most small to mid-sized companies, they don't have a good handle on that. So we take that problem from you and manage
that. And that's something that you helped us with.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. So we did that, and we got you an HR structure stood up and got some organization to your folks.
That was very helpful.
Yeah. So we also with organizations, so for mid to large size organizations, we can come in and do organizational assessments. We can figure out how you can be more productive, how you can change your processes to align with your business mission. And most of that starts with your culture and your leadership. So we come in and we build custom programs for your leaders. We build employee engagement programs. And then also, as I mentioned, we work directly with business people and entrepreneurs. And so we have the School of Executive Presence, and I'm the founder of that school. And I recognize that in order to be successful in today's world of business, you have to be able to show up with presence in a way that people are going to hear you and they're going to see you and value you and celebrate you. So that's one of the things that I'm really passionate about right now. The School of Executive Presence is a very powerful, life-altering experience. And you've been...
Yes, I would agree with that.
Yeah. And, for example, for you, it started with a boot camp, and we're having another boot camp come up in October. Mm-hmm. And we're having it in Washington, D.C. and Indianapolis. And that's really the start of it for people who want to just stand up and start living their mission and start living a life of meaningfulness. And that's where it starts for us.
Yes. Wonderful. Well, how can people get in touch with you?
Well, I'm pretty easy to get in touch with. You could. I have a number of different websites. The best one to go to is thecorporatetalentinstitute.com. So it's www.corporatetalentinstitute.com, and that will lead you to the School of Executive Presence.com and also to thecorporatetalentexpert.com. So with the different divisions of my company, you'll want to start at the Corporate Talent Institute and find your way there.
Great. Well, I know, Angie, we've been working with you, Dr. Prather and I, and our son, who also works in the practice.
Yeah.
We have a coaching session with you once a month, and it's been very helpful.
Yeah.
You know, when you own your own business, there's logistics and managing people that, you know, I felt I needed training in. You know, I wasn't trained in college, I went to school for occupational therapy. Mm-hmm. And so you've been a real asset, and more than an asset, to me, you're a mentor, and I appreciate all you've done for us.
Yeah, I have really enjoyed working with you all. It's been phenomenal to see how you've progressed. You mm-hmm. have the same challenge going on that many other business owners have, and that's you want to perform, you have a business that you're trying to look at the bottom line, mm-hmm. and at the same time you're trying to manage the people and their productivity. And so that's one of the things that I do. That's one of the things that I specialize in, is to help business owners to get out of their performance phase so that they can really manage the business and engage their people. Mm-hmm. And you are, I'd like to capture your testimony sometime.
Yes.
About that. Yeah.
I'll definitely do a testimony.
Great.
Well, thank you, Angie Nuttall, for your time. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
The Prather Practice is located at 8902 North Meridian Street on the north side of Indianapolis, just south of the I-465 loop. If we can help you to achieve better health, we'd love to hear from you. Connect with our office at 317-848-8048. That's 317-848-8048. Join us again here next week or anytime on our website at thevoiceofhealthradio.com for The Voice of Health with Dr. Robert Prather. Are you frustrated by not getting to the root cause of your health issue? Are you tired of not knowing why you're always fatigued? Are you wanting to say no to toxic drugs? Have you lost hope? Are you just tired of being sick and tired? At the Prather Practice, we want you to know that we have the answers for you. We offer the alternative to the disease care model. We are the drug-free model to health and wellness. At the Prather Practice, we look for the underlying cause of your health problem and not just the symptomatology. Through thorough diagnostics, we find your individual health blueprint for your treatment. Where the disease care model is symptom-based, the structure-function model we practice gets to the root of your health issue. The Prather Practice is the most comprehensive wellness center in the Midwest. Our integrative practice offers you the most treatment options to restore your health and your hope. Learn more about the Prather Practice by calling 317-848-8048 or learn more on our website at thevoiceofhealthradio.com.